Good day, everyone. Today we will discuss the topic of preblending or pre-homogenizing. From what I could observe, preblending is something many of our technicians and engineers don't pay much attention to. But preblending is actually the first key process to ensure the uniformity of our raw materials. This will give us stability in kiln operation and proper quality of our clinker and cement. What can be done in the plant to improve preblending effectiveness is very simple. No need for investments or difficult processes. Just pay attention to the way we work. We'll get you through a great deal of improvements. Preblending is somehow like making a cake and eating it afterwards. We prepare layers of chocolate, marmalade, pastry, and then we cut slices for everyone to enjoy similar taste of the cake. We do the same with preblending. Different qualities of raw materials from the quarry are layered and then thinly cut to get a mixture of these layers to feed the raw meal. The purpose is to premix the good and the not so good materials we have in the quarry. This will also help us increase our quarry life. We will focus on the longitudinal preblending system and check what factors influence the system performance and what you can do to improve efficiency in your system. As a rule of thumb, raw material components with standard deviation fluctuations of calcium oxides higher than 1% should be preblended. In addition to pre-homogenizing, there are other reasons for installing and using preblending systems. For instance, it is a fully automatic raw material storage of large capacity. It decouples the quarry operation from the plant, avoiding multiple shifts operation in the quarry, in particular working at night. We can do selective quarrying and premixing of different raw material components using the good and the not so good components, as I mentioned earlier. The longitudinal preblending system is known as batch blending, since one pile has to be formed while the other is reclaimed. And then we change. The raw material from the quarry is stacked in layers to a pile, the one on the left here, and reclaim in right angles to the layers in thin slices on the other pile. There are varied combinations of pile structure and extraction processes. Let's have a closer look to some of these processes. This Chevron system is the most common and simplest preblending type. Longitudinal layers are placed by a to and fro stacker movement over the pile until the full height is reached. Then this material will be afterwards reclaimed in slices transversal to the pile by means of a front-acting reclaimer. Another stacking method is so-called Windrow stacker. Several longitudinal layers are stacked parallel over the whole width of the pile in such a way that they form a triangle after completing the full height. In other words, the stacker not only makes longitudinal, but also transversal movements, forming a pattern of different rows. Reclaiming is always done with a front reclaimer system. You may start asking yourself, in this case, the investment costs are surely higher compared to the simpler Chevron system. So where and why would the Windrow system be applied? Think about it. And this is yet another stacking system. The stacker moves stepwise in longitudinal direction. The next step is only executed after completing the cone up to the full pile height. Reclaiming is done laterally with a side reclaimer. Front reclaimer should not be used with the conical shell stacking method. And this is another question for you. Think about it. The conical shell method is normally used in case of sticky materials and when the homogenizing efficiency is not that important. In other words, when we already have very homogeneous qualities of raw materials in the quarry. The stacking in the homogenizing pit could be both either windrow stacking in longitudinal or transversal layers. For both homogenizing effect, for best homogenizing effect, the transversal stacking is preferred. The homogenizing pit is applied for small preblending capacities or for sticky materials requiring a good homogenizing efficiency. Due to the high investment cost, the homogenizing pit is not normally used where longitudinal chevron system can be used. Reclaim is performed by a bucket chain excavator, lifting and discharging the material onto a bridge and a belt as seen here. So far we talked about the overall systems, let's go into the details of stacking machines and arrangements. For stockpiling the material, there are two types of machines. First, the so-called throw-off carriages or tripper, fed by a belt conveyor installed under the roof of the storage building. This is one of them, the reversing or reversible belt. And this is the second arrangement, the tripper belt. The other type is the side stacker. Because of the counterweight needed to balance the stacker, this machine is wider and required more space within the storage building. What would you think would be the biggest advantage of this type of stacker compared to the tripper type? That is another question for you. We talked so far about stackers, let's move to reclaimers. This bridge type front acting reclaimer, equipped with an extracting scraper chain, is the most applied reclaimer machine. The homogenizing effect is good because it slices off the whole cross section of the pile. The output rate is constant and easy to control. Only a small amount of clearance is needed for the machine inside the storage hall. The working direction of the machine can be changed quite simply. For feeding the exit belt conveyor, the machine requires, on the discharge side, a feeding table or delivery chute. The machine moves continuously into the pile, and the scraper chain is filled progressively towards the discharge end. Because of this, it has the tendency to move slower at the end, where it is fully loaded, and faster on the other side, because there's no material there. Provision must be taken to keep the bridge square to the belt system. There are different types of chain arrangements, in this case the horizontal chain with its discharge chute. Here the inclined scraper chain. Notice a more complex discharge chute over a wall. And a combination of the previous two, a horizontal chain with an inclined discharge end. There are other types of reclaimers such as this one, the side reclaimer. It is equipped with a boom scraper chain that can be lowered to the size of the pile. It is typically used for reclaiming additives stored in the same preblending hall. It has low homogenizing efficiency and therefore should be used with conical shell stacking for materials with quality standard deviations lower than 1% CAO or the equivalent. As we have seen, the purpose of having a preblending system is to reduce quality variations of our raw materials. The graph shows an example of what comes into the preblending hall and what we expect to have after going through the preblending process. Notice that in the longitudinal system, because we're working in batches, there will be notches, changes of qualities whenever we start a new pile. to calculate the efficiency of preblending, we would have to compare what comes in to what goes out of the system. This would require taking numerous representative samples of material and run them all through chemical analysis to determine the preblending efficiencies. There are simpler methods using mathematical models to determine the homogenizing efficiencies. For this, we use the primary chemical material fluctuations, the number of layers, and the geometry of the preblending system. The model says that the efficiency can be defined as the ratio of input fluctuations over output fluctuations. And in turn, this can be assumed to be almost equal to the square root of the number of layers. And how do we calculate the number of layers? Well, it is the cross-section of the pile times the stacker speed divided by the stacking rate. Notice that this formula applies only when we have normally distributed layers. Remember normal distribution, symmetric bell curves. From this formula, you can already start thinking what must be done to keep your efficiency as high as possible in the longitudinal preblending system. There are additional issues with that which will influence the efficiency, such as the so-called end cone. You see here the situation when we change position of the stacker reclaimer. We start consuming a new pile. We face the issue of the end cone. The reclaimer will, at first, consume a limited number of layers. There will be no blending effect at this point. One of the remedies is to stack with the so-called variable reversing points. When forming a new pile, the stacker will slowly be moving towards the outer pile end. We call these reversing points. Because of this, on the inner side, all layers will be open to the reclaimer, while on the outer side, the layer's thickness will change according to the movement of the stacker, again improving the blending effectiveness. Theoretically, the number of these stacker reversing points should be equal to the number of layers. Practically, this is not feasible. A good number of reversing points will give better blending results, of course. An appropriate number of stacker reversing points will be in the range of 12 to 15 for a pile height of approximately 10 meters. Another issue which will deteriorate the blending efficiency is seen on this picture. What is the problem, according to you? Segregation of material, of course. Segregation can also be seen on this picture, where the coarse fraction of the material rolls down the pile while the fines remain on top. We can notice a second issue on this picture. What is it? It is the fact that the pile is not uniform. There are different heights on tops, indicating an improper movement of the stacker and/or an inconsistent throughput of material coming from the quarry or from the secondary crusher. As coarse particles tend to roll down the slope of a pile, mainly coarse material is reclaimed at the beginning. This coarse material will have different chemical characteristics than the average of the pile. On this graph, you can see the percentage of end cones versus the pile. And I also provide the formula so you can calculate your situation. There are a few things you can do to reduce these adverse conditions. For instance, focus to produce a high length-width ratio for the piles. This will reduce the volume of end cones. A minimum value of length-width of 3 should be aimed at, which corresponds to a volumetric proportion of about 15% of end cone. For length-width of ratio of 2, the proportion of end cones will go to 20%. What to do about end cones? Well, and cones at the far end of the pile can be left standing or be only partially reclaimed. Of course, this does not alter the situation at the near end cone. Besides, we could not use the complete effectiveness of the stockpile volume. Another solution would be to recirculate the end cone material to the second stockpile being formed. This procedure is time and energy consuming and can be used only in extreme cases. You can also use the reversal point, as previously mentioned. In this way, the reclaimer will not consume only segregated material when starting the new pile. Finally, make sure that the stacker boom starts very low and is automatically lifted when the pile grows. This way, segregation will be reduced to a minimum. I would like to say something about this integrated preblending system. With the technology available today, we can and should make the best possible usage of our longitudinal preblending system. You see on this graph an example of such an integrated system where two or more components are dumped on the same pile in a controlled manner, to attain a predefined chemical value. This is done with a PGNA, an online analyzer, which continuously monitors the material led to the preblending pile. Corrections will have to be done to the feeding system of the raw mill, of course. Before concluding this session, I would like to remind you that I have asked a few questions, and here they are again. The first one is, why and where would a Windrow preblending system be used instead of the simpler Chevron system? Second question, why should front reclaiming not be used in the conical shell method? Third question, what is the biggest advantage of the side stacker compared to the reversing belt method? And finally, last question, what can be done in your plant in terms of production planning and execution to improve the blending effectiveness and obtain sustainable results? I will not give the answers now, so you can think about it. I will publish a new video later on giving the answers. I would like to conclude reminding you what we've done so far. We focused on the longitudinal preblending system, seeing the different types of stackers and reclaimers, and seeing how to maintain a proper blending efficiency in our systems. In particular, dealing with the famous or infamous end cones. I hope that you could benefit from this short information session. I suggest you discuss with your colleagues and supervisors and find out what can be done in your plant to improve your blending effectiveness. Thank you for your attention and write me some comments and suggestions in case you have some. Bye-bye for now and till next time.